Well, good evening, everybody. My name is Rod Escayola, and I'm your condominium lawyer with Gowling WLG. And welcome to our summer sizzler edition of the Condo Advisors webinar. This is our grand season finale before we take a break this summer, of course, unless the province gets broken again and we need to call back people around the table. But otherwise, this could be our last episode of the season. This evening, we're going to focus on two main topics. We're going to focus on Ontario's new three-step roadmap to reopening Ontario. And we will also provide you with our best tips to navigate a condominium summer. Basically, it's going to be our handbook on how to behave and not break anything while we're on break for the summer. And hopefully, everything's going to be great and we'll meet you in September. Now, I've assembled an amazing panel of speakers. It's going to be the perfect mix of the usual crew that you've come in to love and trust with new speakers. So just get ready to get introduced to new panelists. Well, let's start right away. Let's introduce them right away. And so I'm going to start with José, a staple here in this. Webinar. So from Des Services, the mother hen of all managers, always ready with a band-aid either to care for your scraps and cuts and bruises or to yank it out when the time comes, José Deslongchamps. Hello, José.
Hi, happy to be back.
And you'll see, folks, when we introduce them that we're all sporting our summer outfits. And so that was José in a baseball field. And an eager beaver with WSP engineer, ready to build a birdhouse or a treehouse at the penthouse, we have David Heska. Hello, David. How's it going?
Great, Rod. Thank you for having me on today.
Looking forward to this. I had the opportunity to present with David recently, and I thought, okay, this guy's got to come to our webinars. New to the panel, we have the owner and founder of Results Lifestyle Inc., a drill sergeant and motivating you to swim this extra lap or to do the extra push-up. You know, by hooks or by crooks, she'll get you in shape. We have Penny. Hello, Penny. How's it going?
Good. How are you? Pleasure being part of the panel.
Hey, thanks for joining us. From the National Life Safety Group, always documenting and documenting and documenting safety and security, an honorary member of the Dead Poets Society, Jason Reed. Hey, Jason. Is Jason muted?
He's here. He's muted and he's about to make his grand entrance. Hold on.
I think Jason's undercover.
Nice.
Okay. You're still muted, Jason. There you go.
Good evening, everybody.
Okay, so while we figure this out,
I am undercover. I've got my dress.
Okay, so let's
Good
move
evening,
on.
Everybody.
Good evening, Jason. I think you're coming in and out, but let's see if we can work on this technical sort of challenge. Now, of course, we have your two condo twins. We have your condo lawyer with Gowling WLG, Cram Magnum PI McPherson.
Unfortunately, the mustache isn't quite there, but I appreciate the sentiment.
And to have twins, you need two. And so a condominium lawyer with Gowling WLG wearing pink tonight, just to confuse you, we have the voice of reason on this panel, David Plotkin. Hey, David.
Hello. I like being the voice of reason.
I know. We need that. Okay. So folks, the usual housekeeping disclaimer. We have the chat channels that are open. Feel free to feed into it, to say hi, to share views and points and opinions and so on and so forth. David and Graham, you'll moderate this, but anybody else, if you feel like you have something to add, feel free to share your wisdom on the chat channel. Let me put my Ken Reeves glasses here because it's a bit too dark with my sunglasses. Now, keep in mind the following. When we talk about legislation, we're referring to Ontario legislation for... Oh, you know what? I missed someone. Did
you
I?
You actually missed two someones, I think. You missed Denise and you missed Tanya.
Oh, my goodness.
I thought you were giving me something special, Tanya and I, or there was some reason.
So let me go. You're right. I missed two of you.
It's the hat.
He's jealous of your hat.
No, because he doesn't recognize us.
Well, that's it. So here, the first, a new guest on this panel, we have Wilson Blanchard's VP of Operations, always ready with a fresh set of homemade Jello freezies for you, my friends. We have Tanya Hallock. Hello, Tanya.
Hello, cheers.
Thanks for joining us. And from Lash Condo Law, the queen of condo law, we have Denise Lash. Hi, Denise.
Hi, Rod.
Denise, before we forget, I'd like you to give me more information about CAI's level 2 certification for virtual chairing. I mean, you had the first virtual chairing certification, which was an outstanding success out of this world. And now I think there's a second one coming up. And maybe you can give us information before we forget to talk
about it. Yeah, this is for virtual chairing. And this one would be a really interesting one. It's on June 10th from 10 to 12. And it's a certification program. The basic one will be taught again in October. And I have to mention that Rod and Graham and Natalia and Adam from Condo Voter are the ones that are putting this on. So you've got a great group. You're going to learn how to do adjournments. You're going to learn how to do two AGMs in one, how to handle a requisition meeting, information meeting, and amendments to declaration. So really important to know as a chair, and even if you just want general information, 2 hours, well worth it. CAICanada.com is the website.
Wonderful. Thanks so much. And we're going to put the link when we upload the PowerPoint presentation. I usually do this tonight or the day after. So you're going to get the link there as well. Let me now go back and share my screen so we can go back to the slides. And everybody's wondering, what about Ivona? How come Ivona is not being introduced? Well, she is really Penny's twin. And she's there to keep her under control. Just in case Penny gets overly excited and starts, you know, screaming at us. I mean, Graham is going to start doing push-ups any minute now. So just in case, we have Ivona to keep us under control. So there it is. We now have introduced everybody. Graham, do we see the slides now on the screen?
Yes, we do.
Okay, wonderful. So back to the housekeeping. When we refer to legislation, we refer to Ontario legislation. So you'll have to adapt if you're listening from somewhere else. The information we provide today is as up to date as possible as of 5 o'clock on June 2nd. And most importantly, keep in mind that the information we provide tonight is of general nature. It's there to help you. It may not apply to your situation, to the specific of your situation. It's important for you to go and get advice and guidance from professionals that can look at your very specific situation and guide you. And finally, keep in mind that this webinar is going to be recorded and we're going to upload it on Condo Advisor's website when the time comes. Okay, so we've introduced people. There it is. Let's move on. Okay, here we are. Graham, we're going to turn to you first. Finally, we are jumping in. So folks, on May 20th, Ontario announced that it was scrapping its color scrapbook and was implementing a brand new, simpler three-step roadmap to reopening Ontario. And we've been told that details would follow. And we've been waiting and waiting and waiting. And as of 4:45 today, the regulation hasn't been issued yet. And so we're going to try to shed some light on this, but I mean, we may be missing some of the moving parts here. So I'm going to turn to you, Graham, and I'm going to ask you to help us figure out this roadmap. Is this like a treasure map without the X spot on it? Is that what's happening?
A little bit, but you know what? I think actually to the provincial government's credit, this one's been pretty easy to understand. I mean, I stand to be corrected when the official regulations come out perhaps, but for now, it's been relatively easy to follow. And for everybody listening, I'm going to try and move this one through this one relatively quickly so that we can give time to everybody else to speak. But this helpful chart that you're seeing on the screen here, that's going to be available for everyone to look at too. And that really helps focus in on how the various steps are going to affect condos and what's going to be open when. With all that said, like Rod mentioned, we're no longer dealing with color coding. We're going to be doing it in a provincial three-step plan. And so step one, which is currently set to come into effect on June 14th, or maybe as of some recent announcements, maybe even earlier than that. But as of June 1 or June 14th or earlier, we're going to be in step one. And what that means is that you're going to be able to have outdoor gatherings of up to 10 people. Anyone with an outdoor, well, any condos with outdoor pools and splash pads and wading pools might be able to open with capacity limited and making sure that people are staying 2 meters apart. Your indoor and outdoor recreational amenities the most pressing one that everyone's concerned about being the fitness room, that's going to have to remain closed unless you're a high performance athlete. But those exceptions don't apply to condos. And then short-term rentals are going to be able to resume. And two other big ones that everybody's going to probably be interested in are that all construction projects can proceed and lawn care and landscaping services can proceed. So how the steps work are generally the plan is that about 3 weeks after each step, depending on the amount of vaccines that have been administered, they're going to look at looking into the next step. So the plan tentatively, assuming we go with these dates, is that on July 5th, we're going to be looking at step two. And that's going to increase your indoor capacity limits to 5 people. And so this may be, depending on your board size, an opportunity to have board meetings again, at least in person. Your indoor pools are still going to have to remain closed. So really, there's not a whole lot of difference. The outdoor gathering limit is going to go up to 25. So again, nothing really changing there for the purposes of AGM. So the big main one there is going to be perhaps if you want to, you can have some indoor board meetings again. But I think everyone's getting so used to Zoom at this point, you know, we'll have to see how that shakes out. And then again, another 3 weeks into the future, assuming everything proceeds as planned, larger indoor and outdoor gatherings are going to be allowed. We don't know what size yet. All pools, indoor and open, are going to be, or indoor and outdoor, are going to be allowed to open. And, you know, you're going to be allowed to also use the fitness center indoor and open and outdoor. So, and I think as you'll hear throughout this presentation, just because you can doesn't necessarily mean you should. But what this does mean is that we have a roadmap and we need to start thinking in advance about how we want to open these things and what that's going to mean. I think those are the big ticket items vis-a-vis condos. And like I said, this chart that you're seeing here, that's going to be available for anyone to check out once we post this online.
Right. And in fact, we have a bigger chart with additional columns, but they didn't fit in the slide. So you're going to have access to both. The other thing that I think that's important to take away is this. So it's in 21 days increments. Every step is at minimum 21 days. And the other thing that's important to keep in mind is that there's a lot of details still missing, because in many cases, the province says you'll be allowed to do this with restrictions, but we don't know what the restrictions are yet. And your guess is as good as mine as to what the restrictions will be. If I was a gambling man, I would probably hazard a guess. I think the restrictions will likely be close to what we had under the red zones restrictions, but calling it step three rather than red zone is a much easier sell. It's all about marketing. It's like giving a grilled sardine to a kid and calling it Portuguese chocolate. I can't tell you how often I fell for that. And so I think it's going to be kind of the same concept here, but time will tell. Okay. David, turning to you now, what about the various orders that were into place? Are these changing?
Sure. So the only thing I'll add on this, because Graham's presentation was very, very detailed, is just that the stay-at-home order that it was in existence until June 2nd has now expired. So all that really means is that it's no longer illegal to leave your home for what are non-essential reasons. But I mean, most things are still not open until the 14th. So doesn't really change too much from a practical sense. One of the bigger things to keep in mind, especially for condos that do have a tenancy, you know, owners who rent out their units to tenants, is that the residential evictions are now able to go forward once again. During that stay-at-home order, there was a pause on evictions enforcement. So basically, it was kind of just a holding pattern for owners who were dealing with residential tenancy issues. Now the process will continue, follow the normal process. If you're, again, for owners, issue your notice, your application to the landlord-tenant board, have your hearing, get your order, and then have the enforcement by a sheriff. This isn't really, you know, from the condo level, but for owners, but also for condos to recognize, you know, if they're trying to have their owners enforce a certain compliance on the tenants of the owners, it's a good thing to know that stick is now available again.
Okay, thank you so much. So next, we're going to turn to you, Penny. We finally get to what everybody wants to talk about, the pools. I'm not going to repeat what Graham said, but basically in a nutshell, until June 14, we're in the before stage, and the before stage only allows exterior a spray pad and splash pads. That's the only thing that's allowed now. On June 14th, or sooner, depending on what we've heard today this afternoon, we'll fall into step one. Now, step one and step two are kind of the same in that outdoor water facilities will be open. So whether it's a splash pad or pool, a whirlpool, the slides and so on, with restrictions and with a 2 meter distancing capacity. So step one and step two, you'll have that. But in both cases, the indoor pools will be closed. Step three is when we see the indoor and outdoor pools opening. But so that's sort of the legal side of it. I mean, there's all sorts of steps to be taken even before we get to that point. And when we do get to that point, how to open them safely. And so I'm turning to you, Penny. The floor is yours. Walk us through what people should be working on right now.
So the first thing anybody wants to open up their outdoor pool is they have to submit their opening notification form. What we have done is we have included in the attachment or in the slide that you can see, depending on where your building is located, you can actually fill this online. It's a very easy form to fill out. So if you do guys want to open it, I suggest you do it immediately, just in case if you need to open up, if they will open up 14 days ahead of time. The next thing is right now, if your pool was open last summer for that couple of months, the restrictions are staying the same so far. Nothing has been changed. But I do highly recommend that we also have posted a life-saving society guideline to open up your water facility. That page gets updated immediately when the restrictions or any new procedures come in. So it's good to go to that guideline and see the updated one. But so far, the capacity of your pool, outdoor pool, to be able to open is 20 to 30%. And one of the things that I've been hearing is that when the health inspector comes on site, they want to see your safety plan and your protocols. So they want to see a booking procedure in place because the numbers are limited to 20 to 30%. If you are using a building software, either Max TV, a Building Link, Condo Control, or Concierge Plus, when people book their time slot, you can, we do recommend, and it also says it in the guideline, that it's some sort of a waiver or a disclaimer that residents do understand that you're using the facility at their own risk. And we also like to include all the cleaning time and all the protocols there. So this way they have it. So when they do book their appointment, everything is in front of them. They understand what the what kind of measures that the condo corporation has taken for the safety of the residents. And then when they get, before they enter the facility, they need to get a health screening done. And that is usually done either by a security guard or a pool attendee or a lifeguard, but someone needs to be there. So those are things that the health inspector will also do inspect when they do come in for their inspections.
Okay, let me jump in, Penny. What's the name of that society or site that you're referring us to? So I post it.
It's a life saving society guideline to reopen your water facility.
Okay, wonderful. So we'll post that. And much of the precautions and protocols you're listing now, which are amazing, were in place under the red and the orange zone restrictions. So it's kind of, the signs seem to indicate that we will be able to reopen, but there's going to have to be some protocol, some precautions, so a screening, booking ahead of time, tracing, and so on. What about adapting maybe the actual physical location, your pool deck and so on? What kind of precautions do you think people should consider?
those are the, one of the things is mandatory to do is there's mandatory COVID signs that needs to be posted in your pool area. And the link for each region, Toronto, York, and Peel, they all have different posters. I believe we put that, we will post this for you that you can just click on the link and get access to those mandatory signs. You can print them and laminate them and it will tell you exactly what it needs to be posted in the pool area. Also, floor signs needs to be addressed as well. So it will basically direct the people to enter from one area and exit from one because you don't want them to cross, you know, to cross each other. If you have any outdoor furnitures, they all need to be removed. Maybe leave one, maybe based on the capacity, I would leave half of the capacity of the chairs as long as they're 2 meters apart. Cushions needs to be removed because they can be disinfected. It is recommended that you post your cleaning time. So what we recommend for our clients is that, so let's just say they can swim for 2 hours and there's the 15 minutes cleaning time that they can, you know, fog the area, the railing of the pools and all the furniture is outside, it can be fogged as well. But these things, they have to be in place before you open up. These are the mandatory steps that you need to take, basically.
Okay, wonderful. So a couple of things. People that are chatting, if you want everybody to see your comments, make sure you select not just panelists, but panelists and attendees. That's the first thing. Thank you very much, Penny. That was a very good overview. Also, that sort of reminded me that we've put together a memorandum, a product that lists a very exhaustive list of protocols and precautions that you should consider when reopening your amenities. We'll probably put a link to it. If not, ask us for it. There's about 25 things to consider. There's more, but I mean, I came up with 25 at the time, and they're all very much in line with Penny, what you presented. Now, Penny talked about how the Life Saving Society was recommending or suggesting waivers, and that got us all thinking. And I'm going to turn to you, Denise. We spoke about waivers a while back. And I'm just wondering if the landscape has changed at all on that. I mean, they're kind of limited value to some extent. What do you think?
No, I agree. I don't think anything has changed. But I think what Penny was talking about is when you're signing up online, you just acknowledge by clicking. And that in itself, it's a waiver. So in order to book, you have to click it. And there's an acknowledgement. Look, if you have an acknowledgement, that's great. The point here is that owners should know when they're using the amenities, it's at their own risk. Whether it was pre-COVID or post-COVID or during COVID, it's the same thing. And you know, by saying that you must sign a waiver, and then if someone refuses to sign a waiver, are you really going to prevent them from using the pool? You have to be able to enforce it. So of course, that's my position. And I think, Rod, we were in agreement earlier on this.
Yeah, we still are. We're still in agreement on that one. No, for sure. So the issue is what you just identified, I think, Denise. What if somebody doesn't want to sign it? I'm far from certain that you can impose a waiver onto some people, and if they don't sign it, they can't go in. And the other thing I would say is this. If you're faced with an owner that did sign it, an owner that did not sign it, and they both get injured somehow, like, does that mean the person signed it is in a different situation than the person who didn't sign it? I mean, there's all sorts of legal questions around that, but there's no doubt that sharing information and flagging to your users that, you know, there's some risks and you got to pay attention to the rules and restrictions, that's a different story altogether. For sure, that's good. I'm going to turn, I know you're wondering, where are the managers? They're quiet and you're not used to that. So let me turn to Tanya, who's going to take the lead on this. What do you see, Tanya, on reopening pools? How are people and your corporations and your portfolio, how are they tackling this so far? A lot of resistance or a lot of compliance?
It's both, really. It depends on the communities. We're seeing different things, but what we really appreciate is the frustration of the residents. Everyone has had it with all the restrictions and the rules changing, and no one knows what the regulations. And I liken it to putting a freshly baked cookie on the counter and telling a little kid, you can't touch that. They're looking at their beautiful pools and their gyms that haven't been open. We're saying, nope, not yet. And I just want to make it clear from the manager standpoint, that's not our rules. We're following the regulations as we get them too, as confusing as they may be and ever evolving. It's not up to the manager whether to open or close the pool. We would like everyone to be happy and have something else to distract them with instead of the usual nuisances that are coming up for sure. But our priority is the health and safety of the community, really. So we want to make sure that everyone is safe and the proper protocols are in place so they can be able to use their beautiful facilities, recognizing that that comes at a cost. So to Penny's point of, if you need to have someone go in there every hour to do cleaning, who's doing that? Have you budgeted for that? How are we keeping enforcement has been the biggest challenge. What are we going to do? We can't levy fines. We can't, you know, whack them with a hockey stick if they're closer than 2 meters away from each other. So that's part of the challenge as well, is the restriction. So the booking is great if you have the capacity in your condominium to do that. For some of the smaller condos, that's again another added expense to consider, is who's managing that process. So the health and safety precautions are number one. And then, of course, the protocols and having that in place even before you do your health inspections. How are you going to manage the traffic?
Right. And another problem, Tanya, with using a hockey stick to keep people 2 meters apart is that the GTA has demonstrated that they're not very good at handling their hockey stick. I'm going to turn to maybe you, Jose. Anything to add on the pool front?
I couldn't have said it better than Tanya. People are anxious and looking forward to having their facilities back. And we all agree on that. We all want the facilities open and functioning as normally as possible. And again, it is our job to say no, unfortunately, and we bear the brunt of the reaction sometimes. But please rest assured, as soon as they can be done safely and well and within compliance with all of the regulations, I'm sure that all the facilities and all the boards and managers are working towards that. There's a significant amount of work to be done, mind you, and it doesn't always show. But a lot of it is done from last year. It's a matter of pulling up the stuff that you did last year, making sure it's still applicable, it's updated, and away you go.
Okay, thank you so much. Let's switch gears and let's talk about the other burning issue, which is your fitness room. And I've even seen it in the, we've talked about the waivers. I think we need Tinkerbell to tell me when to turn the page here. So let's talk now about the fitness rooms. And I've even seen it in the chat room today, where people say, well, my public health region advisor told me that we could open the pools and we could open the gyms. And so a question that we keep getting is, well, are you sure, Rod, that we can't open them? So let me sort of tell you how I get to my conclusion. And then after that, we'll talk about June 14th and onwards. Presently, there is no doubt that we fall under the Reopening Ontario Act, and there is no doubt that we fall under Regulation 8220, which is a regulation that implements restrictions to both shutdown zones and gray zones. I mean, you can't argue about that. That's the starting point. Now, this regulation is divided in schedules, and there's two schedules that are of interest if you want to have a look at them. Schedule 2 deals with businesses. Now, everybody, I can see you jumping up and down saying, well, we're not a business, right? Schedule 3 is dealing with places. I think you're a place. I think the condo is a place. And so under Schedule 3, Section 4 provides this. It reads like this. Each person responsible for an indoor or outdoor recreational amenity, must ensure that it is closed. Period. That's the starting point. So if you have a recreational amenity, such as a pool or a gym, whether it's indoor or outdoor, it must be closed if it's in a place. If your gym is not in a place, if it's an outer space, well, then maybe it doesn't apply. Now, it does refer to Schedule 48, Section 48, Schedule 2. So if you're allowed to open under Section 48, Schedule 2, then you could open it. But that section deals with businesses. And a minute ago, you told me you weren't a business. But in any event, even if you were a business, what it provides for is that indoor and outdoor sports and recreational fitness amenities, I think that captures pools and gyms, they can only open if it's for a high performance athlete a professional team, and we know that there's one in the GTA area that would have needed that, and childcare, mental health support, and social services. Okay, so anyways, I'm sorry to be the party pooper, but every party needs one. I'll be the one. Your gyms and pools have to be closed because they're in a place and because they're a recreational slash sports facility. Let's look forward to June 14. June 14, Penny, help us out here. So I guess the summary is that as of June 14, we'll be able to open outdoor recreational slash fitness amenities. And we'll only be able, as we read it now, we'll only be able to open indoor with restrictions on step three. I know we're looking at a crystal ball and we're trying to predict what would be these restrictions, but what do you sort of say that people should do? What's your recommendation? What should we be working on at this stage?
Honestly, it's stage three is so far away, but it's not, things could change. So it's hard to kind of say what the restrictions are going to be. Well, one of the things we do suggest to managers is to have your fitness equipment maintenance, preventative maintenance completed, because your equipment has been down for almost a year, 6 months to almost a year or a year and a half. So they need to be fully inspected, lubricated, and checked. So, and especially when stage three around the corner, a lot of places are going to be opening up, so everyone's going to get booked, I'm sure, your service provider. So we do recommend to get your that's the first thing to do. So far, if the restrictions stay same as last year, it's going to be the similar thing with pool. It's booking online, limited people, probably blocking off equipment to ensure that people are, when they're working out, there's 2 meters apart, health screening test, screening done, all that stuff, and also cleaning in between appointments. What we did with our gyms, we booked them every 45 minutes and 50 minutes time we left it for to be clean so they can maximize their time. So far that's, you know, that's what it says, but the minute the restrictions or the government say anything, I'm sure it's going to be posted online similar to last year.
Okay, very good. And so again, just as with the pools, there's maybe some, you can work on the physical layout, you can remove some piece, some equipment to provide for more room. You could put some signs, traffic signs on the floor and on the doors to sort of direct traffic. I realize that some people have a very, very small gym. Where I live, our gym is in a broom closet. And so even if we wanted, we couldn't really fit two people in that room. I mean, you got to get out of the room to change your mind, but still, it's a fitness room. It's accessible to members of the public as we can define it, in the sense that it's not just mine. And so we're going to keep our eyes up on for the regulation, and we'll try to update you as soon as we know more. Jose, I'll give you the lead on reopening fitness rooms. How's Ottawa reacting here?
Much the same way as with pools, people are looking forward to it. The challenge that we have in our particular portfolio is that we manage some buildings that are unstaffed who have fitness facilities where residents want them open. And then you're faced with, it's fine to book in advance and only have one person in the room at the time, and perhaps you've improved ventilation by putting a filter in and all that good stuff. But who is going to spend that 15 minutes between appointments cleaning the equipment? There is no one, there is no appointed staff. So unless you're hiring a contractor to come and babysit the room, and that's quite costly, as you can imagine, it becomes difficult. And now you're relying on the users to do their own cleaning. You're asking them to use the facility responsibly and respectfully. And then when they're done, to make sure that they clean off everything they've touched, or perhaps you're asking the next person to clean before they use. Maybe that's better because you're motivated by your own safety then to make sure that you've cleaned everything. But that's one of the things that we're finding in smaller condos that is going to be a problem. And if it is actually mandated that you have to clean the equipment between uses and that you can't give the responsibility to the user, then we may not actually be able to open those facilities.
Right. And so one of the questions that keeps coming up, and I think Penny, I don't know if you have the answer, sorry to put you on the spot there. Somebody says, well, when we're talking about 30% capacity, for instance, you know, they look at the actual bather load capacity and then they go with 30%. But then they said, well, when they got their measuring tape out, they realized that in fact, they could squeeze in more people if you were to limit it by the 2 meter distance between the bathers. So how do we get to calculate 30%? Is it on the room capacity?
On the room capacity. So it's, for example, if it's 30 people, so it's 20 to 30%. We have some of our pools that, like I think when somebody also commented, so they allow 15 people, but there's no way you can take put 15 people and keep 2 meter apart. So the board has decided to actually cut down to 7 people at a time. So as long as they can keep the 2 meters and it's 20 to 30%, of the capacity of the room, which is posted, it should post it on the wall in the pool area, then they can go about that.
Okay, and I'm going to say this, the old regulations, the color-coded regulations specifically provided on how to calculate this reduced capacity, and it was really based on size of the room, and there was a bit of a calculation to be done. So anyways, a bit of a mystery, but if we find out, if there's a way to put together a formula, we'll try to guide you. Denise, in 30 seconds or less, the guest suites, because we're behind the schedule. Anything to say about guest suites?
Not much to say. I think it's an appropriate time to start looking at opening guest suites. Now short-term rentals are permitted. Visitors are now permitted. No more stay-at-home order. Just follow health protocols, cleaning, and I think that's a reasonable approach.
Okay, keeping in mind as well the existing short-term rental rules that are applicable to your municipality and to your condominium if we're talking about Airbnb or short-term rentals. Okay, switching gears, we're going to talk about another pressure point, and the point of friction and contention, the barbecues. And we're going to tackle this on two fronts. We're going to first talk about the communal barbecues, and then after that, we're going to talk about individual barbecues on condos. Let me just see here. That's for you, David. That's your slide. So all I'm going to say about communal barbecues is that, in my view anyways, if you have a patio or area or a rooftop terrace or where you have communal barbecues, to me, that is a recreational amenity, right? And if it is a recreational amenity, my reading of the regulation is that they have to be closed for the time being. I realize that that is not popular. And I realize that what if you only send one person to deal with all the burgers and hot dogs and nobody comes close to that person? But I mean, you still have to look at what are the regulations applicable to this amenity, if it is an amenity. But I'm going to turn to, I'm not sure who wants to take the lead on this. Let me just look at people's faces. Who's trying to avoid me? Jose or maybe Tanya. Tanya, you haven't spoken in a while. So how are you approaching this?
A couple of different ways. So some have closed it. They're taking the approach that it's less inconvenient just to shut it as opposed to make additional rules and regulations of how they're going to use it. And someone's got to figure out the maze of forms and documents and bookings, et cetera. Other ones have removed any of the furnishings that were out there. So you can go, you can cook sort of one family at a time, but you can't stay there and eat. You have to just cook your food and then off you go. So again, just like some of the other amenities we talked about, if you have the luxury of having a booking facility where people can do that, and then you have to take into consideration the cleaning and things in between. But I was inspired by some of the comments that to try and keep that 2 meter distancing, maybe we need to consider those human sized hamster balls to keep us 2 meters apart when we're in the pool or gym. It'll measure the 2 meters for us. We won't touch each other.
And now Jose is all excited. You've put a thought in her mind, and I can just see it. I can just see it.
Okay. I see the blog coming on.
Yeah, there's a blog coming on for sure. And so that's for the communal barbecue. And then another common question at this time of the year focuses on individual barbecues on balconies. And maybe I can turn to you, David, and you can share some light on what's permitted, what's not permitted.
For sure. So just from a fire code standard, there's no prohibition on individual usage of barbecues on balconies, but there's so many other elements you gotta look at here. You gotta check your municipal bylaws. These barbecues are not permitted by a number of different municipalities. You see Ottawa, Toronto, Mississauga, Burlington, London. Sorry, they are not prohibited. So they are allowed. I did that double negative thing that I hate, but I did it to myself. They are prohibited by municipal bylaws in Guelph and Kitchener if the corporation has more than two dwelling units, which I mean is everyone. So what's interesting is regardless of whether the municipal bylaws prohibit or permit barbecues on balconies, they all kind of tend to refer back to the condo's ability to regulate or prohibit barbecue usage anyways. So that leads into the next place you have to look. And with every other question we have, it's always you got to look at your governing documents because some condos will permit, for example, electric grills versus gas or propane. Some won't allow any. And in any event, you always got to keep in the back of your mind the nuisance provisions that are always in the rules or in bylaws. Or at worst, you know, you fall back on Section 117, injury to others. And in the new version of the Condo Act, whenever that shaded section of 117 becomes unshaded and comes into effect, there's a specific language in there on a nuisance from noise or smell. So just something to keep in mind that, you know, even if you don't have a specific rule on barbecue usage, you just got to keep in mind not to cause nuisance to others. And just more generally, I mean, be aware of the provincial regs on propane barbecue usage, for example. When you go to Costco to refill your propane tanks, you got to have a certain type of tank, and they won't refill it if it's more than 10 years old. That sort of thing.
Right, and you can't get into an elevator with a propane tank. You have to use a service elevator. If there's no service elevator, you can be in the elevator, but you got to be alone, and so on and so forth. Okay, we're running out of time, but I'm gonna go from David to David. David, now you're on. Give us maybe your top five tips, engineering tip for the summers. What is going to keep you guys busy this summer?
Well, before I do that, Rod, let me cover this bottom point just to clarify for everyone that construction before step one, so where we're in right now, obviously, is still open for residential condos, but eventually will open up. Commercial is currently closed, which has also related or allowed residents with the stay-at-home order. Some people were less willing to allow an engineer who needed to get out and look at their balcony or their windows to walk through their unit. And even we were trying to minimize the number of people we were accessing and bugging. So component evaluations have been rescheduled, and now there's a bit of a blitz happening in June and into July. If you go to the next slide, is my top five, Rod.
Oh, there it is.
There it is. And so I'd say these are things that have kept us busy and will continue as an engineering company doing reserve fund studies and restoration repairs. The health and safety spotlight that has been cast on the contractors doing the work is going to remain. Whether that now shifts a bit gradually away from what their specific hand washing measures are, but continuing to be on top of them in terms of what's their safety protocols. And it's not something that is gonna be a light switch that just turns off. And I think it's actually going to help us be able to have safer sites, not just from a COVID pandemic standpoint, but also from the standpoint of them following other health and safety guidelines. So that spotlight's here to stay. People should also know that they need extra time for building permits. This is not new. It's been the case kind of for the past 12, 18 months as the pandemic has been happening. The building departments have all gone online. And so it's been a slower process to some municipalities weren't ready for it. And we've found that the review process has been, if they said 4 weeks, then in most cases it's 6, sometimes 8 weeks. Contractors are already booked, some of them solid for this year because there were projects that got delayed last year and there was a pent up demand for work happening here in summer 2021. So not only has that backlog of work impacted contractors in terms of they're so busy to trying to hire people, but the fourth point comes in the prices. That graph in the bottom right corner is actually steel rebar. If you're doing a parking garage or balcony repairs, that's the price of steel rebar. I could have put the graph of lumber. Lumber has almost even worse graph than that in terms of the increases in pricing if you're trying to do fencing. So the pricing for projects has gone bonkers in the past spring and summertime, and it's only continuing. I just got an email yesterday from a supplier that says that their products are also increasing in cost and harder to find. So if you're not already locked into a contract with someone, a firm, the contractors are obviously in some cases padding their pricing for, they don't know what the situation may be like in the months to come. And they're also extending some timelines because they know they might not be able to start the roofing project that you want to happen in July. The reality is they might not be able to get polyiso insulation in time or lumber at a decent cost. And then finally, I think something we're always considering with our clients is, what does it mean that residents want to break? They've been home for so long. It was cold and now summer's out and some of us want to be on the beach. So if we are doing a smelly roof replacement project or chipping hammers with your balcony all the way Monday to Friday plus Saturday and Sunday, sometimes you need to consider as a team together, does this make sense? Should we just shut this thing down for Saturday and Sunday? Other clients are wanting a break on their contributions to the reserve fund. And so knowing where your residents are at, what pinch points they have, whether it is taking a couple of days off or postponing the project you're going to start in the summer into the fall, I would say those are some tips we've been talking to our clients about. Back to you, Rod.
Okay, wonderful. Amazing, David. Always very clear. This guy's amazing. I love this guy. We should have you more often. So book some time this coming fall. We're going to get you back on this maybe, you know what you could talk about next time? You could talk about how the reserve fund studies maybe now are a bit out of whack, considering that the price of wood is, you know, has just out of this universe. I'm not sure how we'll be able to sort of keep on track with our reserve fund balance. So maybe something to think about. Okay, so, and you've almost allowed us to get back on time. We're 1 minute late, and that's just in time to turn to our good friend, the safety and security guy. And I think you've changed your background. So there must have been some scrambling taking place. There was probably no good Wi-Fi signal in the bunker where you usually hide. So Jason, turning to you, let me just see, where's your, there it is. So I've divided your slide in three slides. You got 5 minutes to cover them. 1, 2, 3, go, Jason.
Well, thank you, Rod, and some really excellent points that have been said today. And really, I wanted to break down into 3 points here. Number one, there should be some condo security tips that are pressing for this summer, or at least timely to take a look at now. Right now, many of your amenities have been shut down for several months. So a key control or a FOB access control audit, an internal one, you don't have to go and spend money, but an internal one verifying that your keys are where they're supposed to be and who has access to your amenities. So before you start opening them all up, what a great opportunity to kind of audit them and make sure that that is up to date. Finally, exterior lighting. Slip, trips, and falls are the number one injury claim in the province of Ontario. And slip, trips, and falls are quite often related back to poor site conditions or lighting issues. So a great step, one night this week, have your evening security team do a secure or a safety and security review of your exterior lighting and make sure they're all functioning. Finally, bicycles and minor thefts, specifically with vehicles and parking lots. We have seen an increase of these. In fact, in Niagara Region, Toronto, and Ottawa, I've learned of arrests very recently of individuals that have been found with lots of materials in their home that don't belong to them. And the majority of those items were things that were taken from vehicles on properties, as well as underground parking garages, and primarily it was bicycles and expensive bicycles. We could talk in an entire afternoon on the security precautions for that, but that's something to focus on. Finally, item number two, condo safety tips. You are going to see an increase in alcohol consumption on the condo grounds. Why? We're seeing it of alcohol consumption in public parks, and it's been a question raised for municipalities over the last several weeks. So don't think that this question won't be raised, if not already, in your condominium or vertical community. Finally, it's 2021, and I know it's been 15 months, but our code compliance for the last 15 months has not been waived. In fact, nothing has been waived as far as fire code compliance. So that means fire safety plans still have to be annually reviewed. Your staff, have you gotten any new staff in the last 15 months? How did you do training if you didn't have group training available? So it brings a lot of code compliance questions, and it's just another time to take a look at those. The next one was resident spring cleaning. As you can imagine, your residents have been busy over the last 4 weeks cleaning out their suites and storage areas. Where do they put some of this stuff? Parking garage spaces and balconies. So here's the problem. Snow storage of any kind is permitted inside your vehicle parking space other than a vehicle. That means no snow tires. It doesn't mean garbage till I move it. There is no storage permitted in your vehicle parking space. And balconies are a big problem for fires in the summertime. Why? Because in the spring, we overload our balconies, or in the wintertime, we do it too, but then discarded cigarette butts fly onto the balcony and we have balcony fires. Lots of statistics in the last 12 months or 24 months on that. Finally, the third component, amenity reopening. Listen, I've said this for the last 12 months on these webinars, and I'm truly excited to be here. But quite simply, every one of your amenities should have a one-page safety plan. It's that simple. That one-page safety plan, pretend like you're writing a letter to the residents, explaining what you're doing to protect staff, what you're doing to protect residents, when and what time intervals you're cleaning, and then send it to all the residents and post it at the front door of that amenity. We've had discussions about waivers, whether I'm allowed to use it or it's safe. Listen, we are responsible to manage these amenities, and that includes being safe. So create a plan. Property managers, have it approved by your board. And once it's approved, send it to all the residents and post it at the resident so that you're allowing your residents to make informed decisions and know what's being used and what you've been done to there. Transparency and informed use of those amenities is very important. That's all I've got, Rod. I hope I'm not over time.
Oh my goodness. You would be an amazing kids hockey coach. You would just get them running and playing and scoring. That's amazing. Our very own national safety expert. We're on time. I'm going to turn to you, Grim, with the Hawaiian shirt. Yeah, that's you. So something that's just around the corner, and we blog about it every year, is how to deal with excessive patriotism, I guess, when Canada Day comes around. So take it away.
Well, this is a good timing because it's coming up and it's going to come up faster than we think. And so lots of condos have various rules preventing people from, you know, hanging things from the balconies or erecting structures like flags. And that raises the question when people are feeling patriotic, especially around Canada Day. Well, I mean, what are you as a condo supposed to do when people start putting flags out? Or as an owner, should you or can you put a flag out? And so it's hard to say. We do get some help here from a federal piece of legislation called the National Flag of Canada Act. And it tells us that every person who is in control of a condominium building is encouraged to allow the National Flag of Canada to be displayed in accordance with flag protocol. And that flag protocol, you can find it online, but it sets up, you know, how it's supposed to be displayed and, you know, to make sure it's flown with dignity and all that. But it doesn't actually say that you have to allow the flag to be displayed. It says you're encouraged to. Now, that said, if you were here for our presentation, our deep dive on rules, you'll remember that condominium rules have to be reasonable. Now, is it reasonable to put an all-out ban on Canadian flags, especially in light of that legislation I just read? I don't know. I'm tempted to say no, it's not reasonable. And so I think maybe the helpful middle ground here is to maybe set up some rules that set the time frame during which you can put a flag out. Maybe the rules have to show that you can't damage the common elements when you put this flag out, or that, you know, they could mandate the size of it, anything like that. So I think maybe this is just something for condo boards and owners to look deep inside and not start World War III with each other over this. This isn't something you want to be fighting about. Find a way to work together and a way to make sure that that I think that owners can display their patriotism probably in a reasonable way that's not damaging common elements, but in such a way that it doesn't give kind of unlimited freedom and open the door to, well, I mean, if I can put the flag out, then I guess I can build a shed on my balcony.
Right. And the issue is this, is that I don't think anybody's opposed to seeing a couple of Canadian flags on balconies around Canada Day. Everybody's in favor of that. I think the issue happens when October rolls around and the Canadian flag is still there. And the issue is not the flag. The issue is what is the flag attached to? That's the issue. And don't get me wrong, there's no bigger Canadian fan than this guy here. But the way I see it, it's just like pumpkins at Halloween. Get them out, display them, have fun, but afterwards just bring them back in and everybody's going to be happy. So that's how I see it. Okay, folks, we are actually for the first time in our 25 episode history, we're on time. And so I'm going to go around the table. I'm going to thank our good speakers. And I'm going to start with you, José de Longchamp, the mother hen of all managers. Any parting words for the summer?
Just keep your sense of humor. Take some time to relax. Be kind to one another. We'll get through this. It's almost over.
Okay, very good. Thank you so much. And the VP of Operations with Wilson Blanchard, we have Tanya Halleck. Tanya, parting words?
Similar sentiment. Can't wait for the regulations to be over and we can socialize once again. And again, be excellent to yourselves and each other. This is a challenging time for all of us. So just be kind, be nice.
Okay, thank you so much, Tanya, for joining us today. Yesterday during the practice run, she was a little bit edgy, but I think today she decided to be on her best behavior. We'll have her again in September or October and poke at her just to get her going a bit. Thank you so much, Tanya. And engineer with WSP, we have David Heska. David, thank you so much. Any sort of parting words?
No, I think I'll just close off by telling everyone to enjoy the summer, get out there, enjoy the fresh air, enjoy the beach. And if there are any contractors that are bugging you, then talk to your fellow board members and tell them you need a break.
Very good. And if you have any engineer question, go to your local friendly neighborhood engineer and get some advice. It's always less expensive to get advice at the front end than at the back end. Now, the queen of condo law, Denise, also speaking on behalf of CAI. Remind us again, Denise, the dates for this the CAI's level 2 certification.
It's June 10th at 10 a.m. It's a 2-hour workshop. But I wanted to say something. I know this is about working. I'm going to give you a piece of work to all those directors and managers listening. You really need to start planning for your hybrid meetings if you want hybrid. Something to think about is surveying your owners to see if they want to stick with virtual meetings, if they want to have in-person meetings, but perhaps use electronic voting or some kind of hybrid. You really need to plan ahead of time and understand what it means. And I think over the coming months, you'll see, I know Rod, you're involved, Graham, in more webinars on this topic because you really need to plan ahead.
Right. I do think that that is the future of meetings. People have tasted virtual meetings. I don't think anybody is overly excited to go back to putting a paper ballot in a shoebox that's being handed around. I think that regardless of whether or not we're going to meet in person and to what extent and how we're going to meet, there's going to be an element of virtual meeting that's going to stay. There's no doubt in my mind. I mean, who would want to go without electronic voting? I mean, it's just so simple. It's so simple. So yes, let's keep an eye out for that. Thank you so much, Denise. I mean, you've been with us from the very beginning, from our very first episode. I can't thank you enough for that and for your support.
Been great. Yeah, you've done an amazing job, Rod. And I just want to thank you for allowing me to participate in all those episodes. It's been a wonderful experience.
Thanks so much. We'll see you in September. Now, Penny, the coach from Results Lifestyle. Thank you so much for coming. And on such short notice, you did an amazing job. Any sort of words of wisdom or parting words before we go?
Honestly, I know it's going to be a very stressing time when the amenities are going to be opened. Just please refer to the links that's posted on Condo Advisor for your outdoor pools and pools. And that's going to make your life easier. And it's going to help you with your safety guideline to be posted. And just follow the guidelines. So, and then hopefully everything will go as smooth as possible for everyone. Cross fingers.
Thank you so much, Penny. Thank you so much. Now, the hockey coach that every kid wished they had from the National Life Safety Group, Jason Reed, you've also been a part of many of our webinars, and I can't thank you enough for that. And so there it is. We're parting for the summer, but any sort of parting words for us? Do we still have Jason?
Hi, yes. Yeah. Listen, Ron, thank you very much for having me and everybody. Listen, you really deserve a little pat on the back for the simple reason is that I've attended a lot of these Condo Advisor meetings and we've had upwards of 300, 400, 500 attendees. And all of this out of your time, off the off hours typically, and Condoland's really stepped up. So you deserve a little bit of recognition and you deserve a little bit of time off. So one thing I'm going to give everybody one more. Tomorrow morning, I'm going to email Rod a sample, one-page kind of amenity opening, kind of that will cover a lot of the things that people talked about. And I'll give it to Condo Advisor as a Word document. And if anybody wants to download it from there, you can audit it and do it yourself and turn one to each one of your amenities. I'm just thankful that everybody comes together. So thank you for the opportunity.
Hey, that's amazing. Thank you so much, Jason. Okay, well, that leaves us with the two Condo twins. We wouldn't be here if it wasn't for the two Condo twins, the voice of reason and the other one that's here to keep us in line, but he's also here for comical relief and for his good looks. I'm going to start with you, Graham. Graham McPherson, our fierce condo lawyer with Gowling WLG. So, Magnum, take it away.
Well, I mean, in keeping with the introduction you just gave me, my advice is less practical, more just life advice. Consider buying and wearing a Hawaiian shirt. I've been wearing this one all day and I've had a lovely, relaxing day.
Nice. Thank you so much, Graham. And so David Plotkin, the other condo lawyer we have here at Gowling WLG, the voice of reason. You get the final words, I think, David.
Yeah. Well, I see in the chat that Tanya is a Jets fan and just want to say go Habs go. And the Toronto and Ottawa condos don't have to worry about their team's flags flying on the balconies. Ha ha. And just because you can doesn't mean you should. We talked about that one of the early webinars. And now we're talking about it again as we plan through the summer into reopening. So consider what reasonable steps make sense for your condo and wish you all a very happy and enjoyable summer.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, David. And so folks, our next webinar, unless Ontario comes to a screeching halt, our next webinar will be on September 1st, which is the first Wednesday of the month. We're going to be posting the information on Condo Advisor. You'll need to register again. You know where to find the information on Condo Advisor. Top right, there's the webinar tab. If you click on this, it will give you the registration and information about upcoming webinars. It will also link you towards past webinars. If you want to rewatch some of your favorite classics, you can do this by going to the Condo Advisor webinar tab. Folks, I can't thank you enough for spending time with us every month. I have a blast putting this together. I hope you find it interesting and useful. And my turn to wish you an amazing summer, to encourage everybody to roll with the punches. We're almost getting close to almost being near the end of this dark tunnel. Wash your hands, wear a mask, be kind to each other, and let's pull through and meet on the other side of the summer on September 1st. Thank you very much, everybody. Have a great evening.
Cheers.
Thanks, Rob.
Thank you. Thanks, everybody. Great job, everybody. Thank you so much.